Oh, are you here for this?
Or you might be here for this. Well, good news, we've got both, so stick around.
So we've been talking about this for a little while now, about what made myself choose the PS3 and what made Rumble choose the 360.
That's right.
So let's talk about that.
Yeah, but that's why we chose 6 games from each console that in a sense made us choose the console and then also stick with that console.
Exactly right.
All right, so since the 360 came out first, why don't I start then?
Sounds great.
Okay. My first memory of my first game on the 360 was Project Gotham Racing 3. And this was a launch title for the Xbox 360. It's a simulation racer made by Bizarre Creations and published by Microsoft. And this was just one of those perks that I had being friends with people who worked at Microsoft, because I made that transition from the original Xbox to 360 very seamlessly. And we were able to get, you know, cheaper games and then get access to the console early. So this was one of the games that I played, and I typically don't play a lot of racing games. I had played like Test Drive, I played Need for Speed on PC. So this was a lot of fun. And we were doing like career mode, online multiplayer, and yeah, it's a ton of fun. There were 2 games released on the original Xbox, and there were 2 on the Xbox 360. So this was the first of the 2. So
I have to ask, does this game have anything to do with Batman?
Totally does not. No, had nothing to do with it. But it's like a Gotham TV that you're following, if I remember everything correctly, like you're following this TV show or yeah, something like that. So, but it's pretty simple racing. You go around the tracks and stuff, but I remember having a ton of fun with it. So if you ever come across it, definitely check it out.
My first memory for PS3 was Folklore. This was a game that came out, I believe, pretty early on in the PS3 life, and it was so unique and just had such a unique art style. It has unique characters, and even going back and playing it today, I was so surprised at how it's instantly grabbed me all over again. And I was surprised also just to see newer gameplay elements that we don't see even as much today, with the whole like multiple timelines or storylines and how they mix and intermingle. So this game has surprised me even again in 2024.
Yeah, I mean, I saw you play this one. It's definitely an interesting concept. Now, what kind of game is it again?
So it's like a RPG, but it also has like this action battle system, as you can see here in the video. So it is like, it's definitely unique, and it seems like what you are doing, because unfortunately I just don't remember a lot from 2008 or 9, mm-hmm. is that you seem to have these different monsters and you get their different abilities and then you're using them in battle. So it's really a cool concept that I think is still a great one to pick up today if you don't already have it in your collection.
Yeah, I think that's maybe how most people have seen this, just in glass cases in game stores.
I know, I think this one has been rare for a very long time. I think the price has finally come down on it a bit, so I think it might be the right time to pick it up.
My next game is another launch title, that's Call of Duty 2. So I had played Call of Duty 1 on PC. It seemed to be very PC centric, or even on Mac to begin with. And this was a launch title, like I said, for the 360. And again, same thing as Project Gotham Racing. I got access to this one pretty much right away and had a ton of fun with it. I had prior experience obviously with it on PC. But World War II shooter, absolute classic, and this would be the place to start, honestly, on the Call of Duty, on the older Call of Duty games. So this one has a great campaign. I don't think they started the online multiplayer yet, but you know, at least start with this one. Call of Duty 3 isn't quite as good as this one, I would say.
Has there been any other remakes of Call of Duty 2?
No, unfortunately not. So I wish they would remake this one. I think the first one they remade was Modern Warfare, so Call of Duty 4.
So it's worth going back to this one.
Yeah, for sure.
My next one is LittleBigPlanet. I think that this game, by this point in time, is pretty well known. And also we know Sackboy as the mascot for PlayStation. But when this game was first announced and when it first came out, this was a very unique concept that involved making your own levels, or at least modifying your own levels. You have your different characters that you can, like costumes to put on them, you can alter them, you can make them look, you know, yeah, just very unique as well. And yeah, it was the very unique game at the time. This series has obviously gone on as well. And actually, we're still missing Sackboy's Adventure, which we need to get for the PS4 or PS5. We just take our pick, I guess, now.
Yeah, I've always wanted to play LittleBigPlanet, and I heard it was a little bit ahead of its time, right?
When
it came out. So yeah, and I can't believe I haven't played this game. But then again, that's why we're doing this, right? Because I picked the other console, so we're learning as we go.
Yeah, I mean, it was just one of those unique titles that definitely helped me make that decision to go with the PS3.
So now I kind of time jump a little bit, but my next one here is Splinter Cell Conviction. This came out kind of halfway through the life cycle of the 360. Of course, it's a Ubisoft game. So I had a lot of fond memories of Splinter Cell on the original Xbox. And that's essentially what I picked up when I regained my interest for gaming again. Was just basically, I went to a game store and I looked for games that I could start with, and this was it, you know. So it took, I think, 5 years then in between those launch titles and then for me to pick up the 360 again and start playing. So I think this is an amazing game. It's a little bit more, I don't know how to say this, but yeah, the what stands out to me in this game, obviously it's a really good stealth game, you can play it in co-op, but what stands out to me are the enemies. They're so mean to you, like with what they're saying. So you just kind of play it to know what I mean. I can't really recite it. I tried my best to not do too much when I did the gameplay footage. I tried to make sure that didn't convey too much, but it's obviously a brutal game. You have like executions, you can do interrogations, and you know, so they took it to a different level, and it's a little more action oriented as well than the other the older Splinter Cell games, but by far one of my favorite stealth games. So where a lot of people say they started with Metal Gear, this was my first kind of entry into stealth.
I only have played Metal Gear, actually, so yeah, I would be on the other end of that.
Yeah, let's maybe we'll do this in co-op then, and we'll see.
My next one is Disgaea 3, or some people say Disgaea 3, Absence of Justice. This was definitely a deciding factor for me on the PS3, because I played Disgaea 1 and 2 a ton. I mean, I would actually say that I put in the most hours into Disgaea 1 than any other game that I've probably played. That was on the PS2, and I love Disgaea 2 as well, and so I knew I had to have a PS3 in order to play the next Disgaea that came out, and that was Disgaea 3. And I think this game, it even, you know, reinvented it a little bit, because it puts it into a school, so it made it kind of fun to where it wasn't just like it's this netherworld like the Disgaea 1 and 2. Instead, it was like you're set in a school, and instead of going in front of like the judges or the courtroom, instead it's more like this classroom that you're doing, and you're like putting together your classroom with your characters, and you're setting them up at their desks, and whoever is sitting next to each other at the desk, that's like who's going to have a better combo attacks and battle and stuff like that. So they really took the whole school thing and really applied that to the gameplay model that was already in the other, you know, Disgaea 1 and 2. You're very familiar with it. They don't change a lot, you know, but it just applies this whole school level to it. And it's a funny twist on it, as well as like the main character, he's like the baddest of the bad because he's never gone to school a single day. And that, but that's actually good. Like he's the best. And then the girl in this game, she has attended school every single day. So people think she's an absolute like delinquent. Like she's terrible, terrible demon basically, because she's always going to school every day. So funny game, like funny storyline, great gameplay, at least for me when you like strategy RPGs. It's a fantastic game.
Yeah, you talk about these games all the time. So, but yeah, I've seen you play it a little bit, but obviously from recording gameplay and stuff. So.
Yeah, no, they're a fantastic game. And if you are remotely interested, try one of the Disgaea, you know, but they are complicated, I will say.
Yeah, no, it sounds like a great recommendation for that console.
Yeah.
All right, so this is where things start getting interesting for me, at least, and more solidifying why I stayed on the Xbox 360. And
nice.
Halo Reach is the next one here. That was the Bungie and Microsoft. And this, to me, is where things started getting amazing on the console. Since we had, and I had previous experience with Halo from the original Xbox, loved Halo 1 and 2, in particular 2. And then for some reason, my little break from gaming, I didn't play Halo 3. So this was actually my continuation, which doesn't have Master Chief in it. But this game is amazing. Like, I think a lot of people will agree that this is the best Halo on the Xbox 360. And, you know, a lot of people swear by Halo 3. That's fine. I think Halo 3 is a great game. But this one had a different storyline, and it just was, it was great in co-op as well. And, but, you know, at the time I played it solo first, and then later on I found that, oh yeah, let's play co-op, you know, and that's when I really started remembering the Xbox days, how much fun co-op was, even local, you know, split screen co-op and online. And they had the worst internet at the time too, so it was like the laggiest co-op campaign I played with a friend. But it was so fun, and I still, you know, went back years later, did the campaign on Legendary difficulty, and this one, I will say, is one of the harder ones too on Legendary. So it's a ton of fun, and online, even though I wasn't that much into the online gameplay, I still had a lot of fun with that too.
My next one is 3D Dot Game Heroes. This game is amazing. If you haven't seen gameplay for this game, or if you haven't played it yourself, I just highly recommend this game. It was a game that I remember seeing the trailer for this one, and I knew I had to get it day one. It has amazing graphics. Even to today, I would say I'm impressed with the graphics on this game, but also it has this unique, I don't even know if you say pixelated, it's more like cube, little cubified characters that you're like beating up, and then they explode into all these little mini cubes that scatter across the screen. It's just not something you see a lot of still. And I love that they really had this unique take on a Legend of Zelda game, you know, with these beautiful graphics as well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, when I saw you play this, I was like, whoa, this looks like an old school kind of, yeah.
Old
like,
school, new school.
Old school, new school. It was a mix of a lot of different things. I was very intrigued by this, the design of this game, for sure.
Oh, yeah. And then also, you know, publishers, Atlas, and I think that was one of those things that back then I was like, all right, well, obviously, Atlas game, I'm going to give this game a go. And it did not disappoint, and yeah, still think it's a fantastic game.
All right, next one I have is Gears of War 2. So this was actually my first entry into Gears of War, because Gears of War 1 came out in 2006, and this was like 2008. But another, again, fantastic exclusive game that, same as Halo, right? It was their flagship series, and that's when they were good, you know? And then where Gears of War 1 set the standard for the third-person shooter, especially the cover shooter, this just took it to another level for me. Like, it had, like, a really fun horde mode. It had a great co-op campaign. And you can even play it solo, of course, you know, but the multiplayer as well, they improved on that. So this, to me, is the complete package of a third-person shooter. And years and years later, after I played it for the first time, still had fun with friends. If you ever play this game on the 360, you always have fond memories and you bond with someone online. It's one of those games you will never forget. Any of the Gears games, especially, you know. So yeah, Halo the same way, but Gears has like a different dynamic to it where you suffer through it together, you know, you have fun together, and just, yeah, it's just one of those games that everyone who's played it, and I think it goes without saying, obviously, you know, start with 1, 2, and then work yourself to 3, but it's a great trilogy overall. But this is the one to me that was my first, and it's my favorite still.
And definitely made you stick with the 360 for good, probably.
Yeah, and actually I want to show the steelbook here too, because I started collecting steelbooks, and then this is one of the ones that came. I think it's the only Gears that had a steelbook actually, so it's pretty cool. It's mostly silver, but yeah, Gears of War 2, and it has the Lancer on the front there, so that's pretty cool.
I love steelbooks, and I'll show you one too.
Sure.
All right. My next one is Ni No Kuni, Wrath of the White Witch. And when I heard that Studio Ghibli was going to be working with Level 5, which is one of my other favorite like developers, I was so, so excited to hear that. That was like one of those things I never thought, you know, you would see is a, not, you know, we see games even to today where they're Studio Ghibli inspired, but this was an official project that they were working on with Studio Ghibli, and it wasn't just a gimmick. You know, sometimes when you hear those kind of like team ups, you sit there and you think, okay, it's probably just gonna have the artwork, but it's not gonna be that great of a game. Totally not the truth with the Ni No Kuni at all, because that game is fantastic. It is solid. And it's a fantastic RPG, open world, beautiful towns, great memorable characters, great story, but like a pretty sad story actually. But hey, leave it to Studio Ghibli.
Yeah,
right?
I was gonna say, yeah, mostly sad, yeah.
Right? But it's like, I mean, super great game. And there's Ni No Kuni 2 as well, is another fantastic game. You know, again, that they work with Studio Ghibli, you have those beautiful, memorable characters, like I said, and yeah, just highly recommend Ni No Kuni. Also, I wanted to show you a steelbook. It's funny that we both have two. So I was so pleased to find this steelbook on our adventures in Canada. I didn't even know this one existed. And it's just, you know, like you were saying, we collect steelbooks, and this one is just a really cool addition, and it was one of those ones that I didn't know even was out, and so super happy when we found that and that we got to add that to our collection.
Yeah, we're almost gonna have to do a separate steelbook video at this point, because I love talking about steelbooks, and I think they're awesome. That's where, yeah,
yeah, you really get to see the artwork for the game. Like, I love when they get super creative with the steelbooks.
So. Yeah, and the last one for me that really cemented my love for the 360 was Alan Wake. This is a psychological action thriller taking place in the Pacific Northwest, where Microsoft is. So that made things even more fascinating for me. And I know that the company, Remedy, I know the head writer was very inspired by Twin Peaks, so that makes sense, because that takes place in the Pacific Northwest.
Yeah.
But it's just, the fact of the matter is, I didn't play a lot of horror games. Like, I played mostly point and click games, I played mostly adventure games and stuff, and even action adventure. But it wasn't until I played Alan Wake that I really got into the atmosphere, because it wasn't just, you know, you do the tank controls on the older Resident Evil and Silent Hill, right? But this was just more dynamic, more fluid, and you had, you know, obviously your flashlight as a way of survival, and you had weapons, of course, but a lot of it was just shining light on darkness, enemies, right? So, no, I was very intrigued. It was just kind of go, go, go. You had like moments where you kind of slowed things down, it would ramp up again. I think they did the pacing of the game so well. And yeah, I can't speak highly enough of this game. And I think a lot of people that played on the 360, this was kind of a pivotal moment, you know, halfway through where, whoa, I didn't know the 360 could have such a good game with storytelling and everything. So, because it was also very ahead of its time for graphics as well. Like you could even see when they remastered this one recently, it's basically taken the same engine and, you know, they just basically did PC graphics, but that's how good it really was.
Remedy is so good at that, and Remedy does a great job with the storytelling and the mm-hmm. games that I've watched you play. And yeah, Alan Wake is no exception for sure.
And I should say that too, like the main reason I knew about this because I played Max Payne 1 and 2.
Okay.
That's how I knew about Remedy. So it was kind of, I didn't know this was an exclusive, but then I go, Remedy, Xbox. Yeah, so it was an instant hit, honestly. It was a fantastic game.
Yeah, I love watching you play the Alan Wake games. Obviously, I cannot play a whole lot of the scary games myself, and that's why I like watching you play them.
Yeah.
My last one is Persona 5. This game came out way later on in the life of the PS3. I believe it was even released on both the PS3 and the PS4 at the same time due to that. But I played Persona 2 on the PS1. I played Persona 3 and 4 on the PS2. And that was a game that I was waiting for on the PS3. I knew they would make another Persona. I just didn't know I was going to have to wait that long for another Persona. But it was absolutely worth the wait. And I think I've played Persona 5 at this point at least 3 times probably. I mean, it's like they've come out, you know, with different versions of it. And then I know I played it, you know, on the PS3. I played it on the PS4. But then when it came to Xbox and I knew it had achievements, well, I had to play it all over again. And I had to 100% that game. And again, achievements showed me so many different like sections of Persona 5 that I probably didn't play before. So I love Persona 5. I don't regret playing it 3 times at all. It's a masterpiece. And I think that, yeah, if you haven't played Persona yet, Persona 5 is actually a great place to start too, by the way, because I think that they just simplify some of the rules, some of the battle systems that makes it easy to jump in to this, you know, RPG. Well, thank you so much for joining us as we walk down memory lane on the games that made us choose either the PS3 or the 360.
And we'd actually love to hear from you guys in the comments. Which console did you pick and what memories do you have from it? Which games did you play?
Thanks for watching and we'll see you next time.